Hello, this is Vic. Welcome to my channel. Thank you for viewing my videos. Today I'm in the beautiful and exotic French Polynesia, and I am on the spectacular island of Tahiti. In this particular documentary, we're going to go around this magnificent island and we're going to videotape the sacred sites of Tahiti, or the Marae as they are known, M-A-R-A-E. We're going to look at least three of them. We're going to walk around them and I'm going to explain to you the architecture and their function. Let's go for a tour. This is the most magnificent island in the world, but also one of the most historic here in Polynesia. Let's go. Let's start our tour of the sacred sites of Tahiti by looking at the most spectacular one, the Marae of Arahurahu here in Tahiti. This site is located about 20 kilometers outside the capital of Tahiti, the city of Papeete. And you have to take the bus in a counterclockwise direction in order to get here. Just before the Marae, there is a very big square, as you can see here. You can see on the ground the lava rocks forming a beautiful square. Let's walk towards the Marae and let's try to see if we can explain some of its characteristics. Now, the Marae is enclosed by a wall that you see here. On the outside, the stones, the lava stones, are laid very neatly, as you can see here. In the corners, there's a big vertical lava stone here. The wall is about 1 meter in height and a little bit over a meter in width. And here, in the middle of the front-facing wall, there were steps here originally. The size of this Marae is about 20 meters in length and about 15 meters in width. Now let's look at some of the characteristics of the Marae. I need to mention to you that each Marae, not only in Tahiti, but right across Polynesia, has its own characteristics. The layout is different, the size is different of each Marae, but there are some features that are very common, and one of them is the stone that you see right there in the middle. That's the kneeling stone. This is where the ariki, or the chiefs of the tribe, would be kneeling against, praying, while the high priests would be on top of the three-tiered pyramid that you see at the end, the altar. So as the ritual is taking place, the ariki would be leaning against the stone here in the middle, praying, and only the ariki, the chiefs and the high priests, would be allowed on top of the pyramid, the altar that you see at the end of the Marae. And that's because only the ariki and the high priests were considered to be representatives of the gods here on earth. So not only the kneeling stone that you see there, but also the altar is very, very common to each of the Marae. But the size of the altar differs, and what makes this Marae very spectacular is that it is a three-tiered altar that you see right there. And you can imagine here, the high priests are on the 15th century being on top of the pyramid performing prayers and rituals and so on. Now the space, once you cross the wall here, is sacred. Only the high priests and the ariki were allowed in this space. The vertical pieces of wood that you see will be of three different kinds, with human figures, animal figures, or geometric figures, and they will represent the spirits of the dead from the tribe. And also here in this corner, on the left side, once you cross into the inner space, it would be a shed covered, a wooden shed full of food for offerings to gods. There will also be space in here where small wooden figures of gods will be placed during rituals. You see a sample of one right here. This is not an original one, but you get an idea what they would look like. They will be placed somewhere next to the altar. So now let's go around and let's get closer to the altar. So let's walk this way so you can see how neat the position of the lava stones or rocks, how beautifully they are placed. And here's the altar. Three terraces or levels. The first one is about 2 meters in height, the second one 1 meter, and the third one half a meter. Here you get an idea of its construction. Now this marae here in Tahiti have been dated to be in existence since the 15th century. But there is a possibility that some of them existed as early as the 10th century AD. So imagine if you were here on the 15th century and if you were allowed to attend these rituals, the high priests would be standing right up there, surrounded with the surroundings here, the thick forest, tropical forest. Now this area here is vast. This is the only part that is remaining. But if you walk around, you will see evidence of other structures as well. For example, this area here has been cleared. But if you walk down this way, you will see evidence of walls and so on. So this place here where I'm standing at, quite possibly had other buildings as well. This is the one that has remained intact, including the front square right here. Here's another view of this absolutely remarkable place. Very historic, very significant.
Now I want to further clarify a point that I made earlier. The point was that each marae is different in its layout and architecture, not only within Tahiti but within Polynesia as well. Now there are some common points of each marae, like the altar and the kneeling stones that you just saw, but let me bring a point a little bit closer to you so that it's more comprehensible. Let's say you're trying to describe the Gothic churches between the 13th and the 16th century in both France and Germany. There are many points about the Gothic churches that we'll find common in all these centuries and both in France and Germany, but each Gothic church will have its own characteristics. And that's the main point here as well. Now, to confuse the matters a little more, is that in the Cook Islands, we saw marae that served not only religious purposes, but social purposes as well. Check my channel, you will find a marae from the Cook Islands where wedding celebrations took place, for example. But in this particular case here, the marae that we're seeing in Tahiti are pure sites, sacred sites for religious purposes only.
Now the marae is about 200 meters in the far distance. What you see here is right in the front of the whole site. This is the first part of the site that you would cross to get to the Marae. You can see another square, another plateau here. But there are so many unexplained buildings here. You see this rectangular building here, surrounded by rocks. There's no entrance to it, but there's a stone right there. What is the function of this room, or this space? We do not know. Now, this space here is leaning against a much higher structure. Another platform over here. Quite possibly this is a platform where the chiefs and the priests and the warriors would meet before a religious festival or ritual. And then from here, you would have to go up the steps to another area, another flat area. You see these ancient steps right here. You could cross this area over here. And the Marae, look at it in the far distance, about 150 meters from here. So this whole area here that you see is a holy site. At one point in time, there must have been many different buildings with different functions all around. But nobody can really explain what exactly was taking place here in each one of these areas here. Incredible. Absolutely incredible. Now, there are many things that we do not know about this very important, very historic site. For example, there are trails all around this site here. What do they lead to? Let's follow one and let's see what they look like. Now, for those of you that have been to Peru, this will bring memories back to you regarding the Inca's trail. Now, that's the Marae up there. That's the one we just videotaped. See it? Right here, you can see a wall to my right, but there's a definite trail here. Ancient trail. You can see the stones on the ground. Now, this trail goes around the Marae. Look at it. You can see evidence of this road right here, and then it continues this way towards this big mountain that surrounds the area. Let's be patient for a second. Let's go a little higher and you will see my point. And then the trail ends. So quite obviously something has happened here, and either the mountain has collapsed or the caves that were here do not exist anymore. Here's the trail, and it stops about 10 meters in front of me, and that's the Marae right there. So this here, this whole area, is a sacred site. Everything around it, this whole valley here, was a holy valley, a holy place. So what exactly took place here in this whole area? Not just on the Marae right there. Who knows?
Wow, what an incredible sight indeed, what a historic sight. You can always tell my excitement when I visit historic places, and it is reflected on my face. Half of what you see on my face is from exhaustion, trying to cover all these historic places in 36 degrees Celsius and about 98% humidity. And the second point that you see on my face is the excitement from visiting these spectacular places. Now let's go to the next Marae and let's see what
surprises we're going to encounter over there. Come on.
And now let's look and examine in detail another very important, very sacred site. This is Marae, Tahiti, which is located on the 19th kilometer of the road, the circles, the large island of Tahiti, traveling in a counterclockwise direction. This very important, very ancient site dates quite possibly from the 13th century, and it has three marae, A, B, and C. We're going to look at them in detail in a few moments. In front of the marae, there is a raised platform about 1 meter in height, 10 meters in length, and 4 meters wide. Let's go closer so you can see its construction and its structure. Now, this is the platform where the warriors, the priests, and the chiefs would meet to discuss several matters regarding the different tribes here in Tahiti. And right behind this platform, there are three massive marae. This is Marae C, the one on the right side. Each marae is surrounded by a wall with neatly placed lava stones or rocks right there. And its marae has a kneeling stone right there. You can see it in the center. This is where the chief or the ariki would lean against during religious rituals. At the other end of the marae is the altar. Now, this particular marae is important because there are three stones right here that you can see. And around those stones, a lot of human bones have been discovered. And historians believe that a lot of important chiefs were buried here, but they only discovered the bones without the skulls, which means that once the body was dried, the bones will be buried here and the skull will be given to the family of the deceased. Next to Marae C, there is an adjoining structure here, and they cannot explain what this building, what the function of this building was for. But let's go this way. Let's go to Marae B. Now, C and B are separated by this space here. Right here, you can see the two different walls separating B and C. B here has a pile of stones. And the function of these piles of stones has not been explained either. And then here's A with a kneeling stone. We're going to see the stone in a moment, right there. And again, this is where the ariki would lean against as the priest in the far distance would perform the religious rituals. Here's an overall view of this very sacred site. Look at this. Here's the platform where we just saw. In the far distance now, in all three marais, there's an altar, a raised altar. The altar here is raised for about 80 centimeters on one side and about 30 on the other side. Let's go close to see if we can videotape the altars, because in this particular marae, there's a little structure right there in the corner where little wooden figurines of gods we placed at during the ceremonies. But here's another view of this very important site. And if you ever come to Tahiti, without a doubt, you're going to see the signs on the main road, and you're going to stop here, and it would be worth your time and effort to learn a little bit about these structures here and what they represent and why they are built this way. And here's the altar of Marae Sea. This particular altar is surrounded with flat stones embedded into the ground, whereas the altar of Marae B that you see here is a raised platform right there. Let's go look at the altar of Marae A. So you can imagine sometime during the 14th or 15th century, the high priests standing on this altar here, performing religious rituals and ceremonies. Now these Marae A, B, and C were used exclusively for religious rituals and not for social events, as it would happen with some other Marae here in Polynesia, especially the one in the Cook Islands, the Marae of Kainuku, which served both religious and social events. And here's the best preserved altar of the three Marae. This is Marae A, and you can see the altar right here. You can see B and C beyond the wall of Marae A. And that's the kneeling stone right there in the middle of the frame, right there. You can barely see it. So the ariki would stand about 15 meters away, leaning against the stone as the priests were performing religious rituals on this altar here. Now, between this altar and the far wall that you see there of Marae A, there's another small platform, and that's where they would place the wooden religious figures, the gods, during the rituals. Now, why the Marae were built at such angles, and they are different in size and not exactly square or rectangular, is a mystery to everybody. There are a lot of unresolved and unanswered questions regarding this ancient sacred sites here in Polynesia.
Now, there are so many questions that are left unanswered regarding this specific site over here. For example, what are these piles of stones in Marae B? What is their exact function? We do not know that. What about the building, which is joined to the outside of the wall of Marae C, the small rectangular building? We know nothing about that as well. But what about all these people, the bones that they were discovered here? Whom do they belong to? Did they really die a natural death, or did they die as a result of a human sacrifice? And to carry that further, were there any human sacrifices taking place here? And the last question is, of course there are many, but the last question as far as I'm concerned is, how old is this place? There are signs here that say most of the Marae in Tahiti were built between the 13th and the 18th century. This is one of the oldest. But another sign says some of them were built as early as the 10th century AD. That would make it over 10 centuries old. What an incredible sight. Let's go look at some more. Now, I just got off the bus here in Tahiti. I'm on the 39th kilometer outside the city of Papeete, going counterclockwise direction. And I'm going to visit the Marae of Mahaiatea, which promises to be a spectacular sight. According to the Lonely Planet, it's an immense site
of over 80 meters in length. I can't wait to see it. So all I have to do now is walk from the bus stop towards the coast, and this side is right next to the beach of Taharu, a very popular beach here in Tahiti. So let's go and see what we're going to find, and hopefully we're going to be able to climb on the side so I can explain to you the different parts of the Marae. Let's go. And approaching this ancient site from the main road, this is the first view of the Marae. Marae Mahaiatea. Now, James Cook in the late 1700s visited this site, and he described a magnificent Marae of 80 meters in length by 30 meters wide. And look what is left of it now. Just a hill of trees, a pile of rocks. Let's walk around. We're very, very close to the coast. You can see the waves and the sea, the Pacific right there. Here's a view of the Marae. There's not much left of it. Everything is right here, piled up, completely unexcavated. This place at one time used to be a parking lot for the beach or a car park. You can see a wall built around it. The wall belongs to the private residences to my left. But here's the site. It is still immense. You can see the pile of rocks right here. You can see one layer of rocks here. That would be the very first level or terrace. And then there would be another one here and another one continuing all the way up to the top. And James Cook described a pyramid in the center of this Marae, rising 13 meters in height, about 40 feet. You can see the rocks, coral and lava rocks that used to form the original Marae, just piled up, trees all over the place. Now let's go up to the top. Let's go up to the top right there and see if we can find anything. Let's see if we can see anything from the top of the pyramid where the priests would stand and would perform religious rituals. And where now it is doubtful if you can stand without stepping on garbage or overgrowth vegetation. Let's go to the top. I'm now in the middle of the Marae on top of what used to be a 13 meter pyramid. I'm about 40 feet off the ground, off the base of the Marae, and all I can find up here is lots and lots of garbage, rubbish everywhere, and overgrowth. You cannot see anything up here. It is so disappointing, such an ancient site, to be covered in garbage and bushes all over. Oh, what I would give to excavate this place and to bring it back to its original glory and shape. How disappointing. The base of the Marae is quite visible here. You can see the stones that once were part of the base. And there is a lot of overgrowth all over the place. There's something else which is very disturbing here. This place is absolutely full of garbage. Such an ancient site, so neglected, so disappointing. But let's walk around and let's look at what is left of this once very sacred site, the Marae of Mahaiatea. There's not much left of it.
just a pile of rocks, overgrowth, bushes, garbage. And if you're a historian and you're really looking for sacred sites in the Marae here in Tahiti, this place will very quickly disappoint you and leave you with a bitter feeling. Let's walk around so you can see more evidence of the neglect of this ancient historic site. And here's one of the corners of the Marae. This is the side they used to face the Pacific Ocean right there. And you can see the garbage, and you can also see it is being used to keep canoes. And right behind all these bushes and the vegetation is the Marae. Unfortunately, this is the image that you will see if you visit this very ancient place. Now, behind the trees, there is a lot of evidence of walls. So right behind the main tree over here in the middle of the frame, there is a wall. So there must have been the fifth terrace or level going up towards the pyramid. Actually, let's go closer and I will show you. Here you can see the rocks. Over here you can see evidence of a wall right there in the middle of the frame, forming one of the terraces or one of the levels as you go up to the top of the pyramid. Now I want to close this part of the documentary by telling you how really disappointed I was. I was expecting to find this immense structure that I could videotape around and explain to you the different parts of it. Well, what you saw was a pile of rocks, lots of trees, overgrowth, and lots of garbage. And as a historian, I am so disappointed. I get so disappointed every time I visit a historic site and I see such neglect. It is really very difficult to comprehend how the people that own this site, the government, neglect it. And they don't really care about this. And if they want to improve tourism and take advantage of their history in order to improve tourism, they need to fix this, they need to excavate it, they need to put signs around it. And they have done absolutely nothing. All they have done is they put some huge rocks in front of the car park, the parking lot here, so that the cars don't park around it anymore. Well, that was a huge improvement. People can still come here, and there are drinking glass bottles all over the place here from alcohol drinking, that is. Very disappointing place, and I'm a very disappointed person. Right now I am.